My job is to talk a little bit today about where CF is with research and drug development. Thank you, most importantly, to Dr. Rosen. He did a great talk. That's it. That I usually have to put a little bit of that in my talk to make any sense out of that. Now I don't have to do that at all. So what I'm going to try to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about what drug development is. What we do. How this whole process works. Sort of explain to people. You hear about all these medicines, and as a family member, you're like, okay, all this stuff is out there. Why can't I give that to my child, my husband, my wife? Why do we have to wait? And I'll try to explain that a little bit. A real brief history, because again, Dr. Rose mentioned part about what the problem is in CF, and then the current research, where we are, what's going on with the drug development pipeline, and the search for the cure. The mission of the CFA, this is the official CF Foundation mission statement. It hasn't changed in a long time, and it's because that the goal has not changed. It's to ensure the development of the means to cure and control cystic fibrosis. Prior to the last couple years, it was more on the control part, but now, as Dr. Rosen alluded to, and as I will hopefully explain a little bit, the cure is in sight. It's actually here for a very small percentage of the patients. And to improve the quality of life for those with the disease. John mentioned all the quality improvement work that he does. And that's involved in both quality of care and just quality improvement, quality of life. CF Foundation funds a lot of different kind of research. It funds the basic research that has found this gene, found how it works and how all that looks at the bacteria that is involved in CF and causes a lot of damage in CF. You have to know your enemy to be able to fight it, so they find out a lot about the bacteria. And then genetics, which Dr. Rosen summarized beautifully. Clinical research, drug development. That's what's sexy. That's what gets all the headlines. Looking at new drugs for CF. Looking at new versions of established drugs. Tobin is inhaled tobramycin. Tobramycin is an IV antibiotic that's been around for ages. But the IV form of it was not necessarily real friendly to the lungs if you tried to nebulize it. So a company originally called Pathogenesis, now owned by Novartis, went and found that drug and made it in a way that could be nebulized and looking for new treatments. Organization standardization and efficiency. CF affects about 30,000 patients in the United States, about 70,000 patients worldwide. That's not a lot of patients either to run drug studies or to get drug companies interested. So you really have to have organization, standardization across multiple centers so you can do a study that's valid even though it's done in multiple places. And efficiency. You need to prove to drug companies, yes, you can get these studies done. The CF Foundation will help support you and we can help bring these drugs to market. Therapeutics Development Network was established about 15 years ago, originally a very small number of centers that has now been expanded to 77, and for the last 5 years we've been part of that. 13 of them do kind of what's called translational research, which is going from the basic research to the clinical. The rest of them, like we do mostly the clinical stuff. This is the map that shows where all the centers are across the country. None in Hawaii currently. There is a CF center in Hawaii. But, so if anyone wants to transfer their care somewhere nicer, you can go to Hawaii. But there's a TDN center up in Alaska. Of course, the most important center is right there. The coordinating center is out in Seattle. The foundation is down in Bethesda. Actually, we can say that we truly are the number one center. We are number one because we are center number one. Now, it's probably alphabetical more than anything else. But hey, I'll take it any way we can get it. How does drug development work? It's a long process, and there's several phases, and as you hear about some of these things, you sort of need to understand at least a little bit about it. There's a preclinical, what people call bench research, which is, the tissue, the test tubes, the tissue culture, some animal studies. There's a mouse model of CF, which is now, they've now given us some pigs CF. And then you get into the human studies. Phase one studies are initial safety studies. Don't involve CF patients. And this process, although I'm talking about for CF, is applied to any drug development for any disease of any kind. So phase one, you don't do with patients of the disease. You just give it to a few people, say, okay, does anyone keel over and die? you know, is there any bad side effects? Phase two, you do small studies in CF patients. Again, the main goal is for safety. Well, you do get a little bit of evidence if it works. Those can take up to a couple of years. And then phase three are the big ones. And most of the studies that we are involved in here at Albany Med are phase three. We do a couple, you know, late phase two, which gets our research team very involved because they're very detailed, very involved studies. But phase three are large studies, basically trying to say, does this medicine work? Is this a potential therapy for cystic fibrosis? And also, obviously, to be sure it's safe in large numbers. Those can last several years. The FDA requires that drug companies do at least two separate phase three studies before they can apply for FDA approval. And that can take several months or longer. Now, fortunately for CF, CF's been classified as what's called an orphan disease. There's several others. Basically, it means it doesn't affect, you know, large numbers of people, especially compared to something like asthma or cancer, but it gives certain benefits. And one of the key benefits is faster approval by the FDA. Everyone has heard about, and I'll talk a little bit more about, Kalydeco or Ivacaftor. Every drug has at least two names, just to confuse everybody. And that drug, I think, was submitted in November and was approved at the end of January. That's the fastest drug approval I've ever seen, and it's probably the fastest drug approval in FDA records, because the FDA realized how important this was and what a true game changer that this was. It's not a purely linear process, and like, okay, I've got drug extra special here, and then I just will run it all the way through. It's a process where you start out and looking at things at literally thousands of compounds. You get to some preclinical studies if you drop down and you bring some to your clinical trials, and if you're lucky, you'll get to the end. A lot of drugs drop out, and this is not against CF. Specific, this is new medical enterprises is what they call this, basically any drug development, which just start out with a lot, and before you can actually get out here where I as a physician can write a prescription and give it to a patient, you know, it really willows down. And even here, the phase three is not 100% successful. CF, unfortunately, has had a number of drugs that have gotten to phase three trials we've been very, very excited about, but just have not made it through there, have been shown either to have unanticipated side effects, or more importantly, or more often, I should say, and just have not worked as we thought they would. People have heard about this. This is available on the internet. I'll probably show this slide here and highlight various parts of it about five times through this talk. This is a CF Foundation therapeutic pipeline. This is a drug development of the United States, of the North American CF Foundation. This is not the only CF research that's going on. And sometimes people look at this and say, oh, that's all that's going on. No, there's NIH funded separate from the CF Foundation. The Canadian CF Foundation, the European CF Foundation are all doing lots of trials. But this is what's going on in this country. And I talked about the phases. As you look at this pipeline, you'll see it starts with the preclinical and then comes to the actual available to patients. So all the drugs that are in this column are ones that we can prescribe now that are out there and available. The studies are done placebo controlled, meaning a placebo is a sugar pill. Some people don't get it, which is one thing we often get people asking to be in a trial because they want the new drug. That's a bad idea. 50% of the people in a trial usually will not get the drug. They'll get a placebo. And if that happens, your priority is a little less. But one example, Dr. Rosen mentioned that we use other antibiotics other than tobevibrin. Tobevibrin is the only FDA-approved nebulized antibiotics, but we do have some people do others. If you're on one of those antibiotics and you hear about a trial, you know, for a new form of that for nebulization, if you're on it and it's helping, we've had people ask, say, hey, can we get into this trial? And my advice to them is, no, you don't get in the trial. You don't want to be in the trial because this medicine is working for you. And if you go in the trial, you may not get the medicine. So don't join trials just to get the new medicine. I'm not going to talk a whole lot about, you know, whether you should or should not be in trials. There are some, you know, information about that. They've got a poster out there about the trials that are going on. Some information, including, by the way, a nice little article John Nash mentioned earlier, that Mark Guntram is Mr. Clinical Trials. Well, he actually got interviewed and published in a magazine, and there's a couple printouts of that over by the research thing. So if you want to get a little preview of our speaker this afternoon and take a look at that, you can see it. And a really cool picture on the second page. Anyway, Dr. Rosen mentioned this a little bit, so I'm just going to go real quickly. But because you need to know what's wrong with the CF1 to figure out what we're doing the treatments. The CF protein's right here. It's a chloride channel in the body. You know, where chloride goes, sodium goes to keep things electrically neutral. And where salt goes, where sodium chloride goes, water goes. So normally in the lungs, you've got these little hairs that Dr. Rosen drew quite nicely, and they live in fluid, and they're the brooms. The cilia are the brooms of the respiratory tract, and they sweep out the mucus. In CF, that channel is missing. The chloride stays in the cell, sodium comes in the cell, water comes in the cell. Water's not out in the lungs, the cilia get crushed down, they don't work. And so instead of having a nice open airway down here, you've got an airway that's very inflamed. It's been a long time since I've done histology in medical school, but I still remember purple was bad, purple was inflammation. So there's a lot of inflammation, and there's a lot of junk blocking up the airway. This is the other thing, if you look in various stuff for CF that you'll see and talk a lot about, which is the vicious cycle of obstruction, infection, inflammation, and bronchiectasis, which is lung damage, and the preceding factors, which Dr. Rosen talked about quite nicely, the gene, the protein and the changes it makes. All the current therapies we have right now, with the exception of Kalydeco, are looking down here. But just because we're looking up here now with Kalydeco and other things, that doesn't mean that there's no research going on down there. There's still a lot of areas that are looking at ways we can better treat patients with CF. Because even curative treatments are not going to get rid of damage that's there. They're not going to fix everything. I think Dr. Rosen mentioned that, and I will certainly second it. Even our patients who have G551D and are on Kalydeco, we tell them over and over again, you need to do your other treatments. It's a wonderful drug. It does not fix everything, and it does not change what's there. 10, 20 years from now, or whatever time it comes, when we can give a newborn Kalydeco and treat them for the rest of life and prevent all lung damage, or give a newborn whatever drug that we need for their mutation, that'll work. And that's not where we are now. You have to keep doing the therapies, and so the research goes on for better therapies. The current one's being studied. For obstruction, there's a medication called Bronchitol. It's in the last phase of study, phase 3. It's actually been approved for something other than CF. And the studies are going on, so it'll be FDA approved for CF. It's actually approved as a testing mechanism already, so that medication will almost certainly be out soon. Better drugs, other inhaled antibiotics to help better treat the many bacteria that are in CF. And anti-inflammatory medication. Inflammation, control of inflammation is the one area that we are probably weakest in our treatment of CF. Because it's tricky. If you suppress inflammation too much, which we can, with medicines like prednisone, then you get too many infections. But if you don't suppress inflammation enough, you get lung damage. So there's a number of things that are being studied, including anybody out there in pharmacy or anything else know what the what the common name for sildenafil is? Yeah. Sorry, say that again.
Viagra,
exactly. So that's a study that I think that they don't have a whole lot of trouble enrolling people in. But it does have anti-inflammatory effects. What I'm going to talk for the rest of the talk about is what it's called, potentially definitive treatments, treating the underlying defect, basically cures for CF. We try to use a lot of euphemisms, but we're looking at treatments that will cure it. And there's multiple ways you can do it. Dr. Rosen talked about gene transfer, gene therapy. You can give the gene, you can deliver to the gene the lungs. That works. It's been done. It's been done since shortly after you found the gene. The problem is it's temporary. The body is very smart at getting rid of things that it doesn't think should belong there, and we haven't found a way to transfer the gene and have it expressed for long, long times. But that's still being studied. Not much in the U.S. now, but a huge process still ongoing in Britain. And that, you know, that would be a definitive non-specific. All we talked about the mutations in your genes, you don't need for this. We don't care what mutation it is. If you have the only mutation in the world, you know, if you're literally one in a million, gene therapy would work for you. A lot of research has been done looking at trying to fix other proteins that are on the cell surface that serve as channels for other ions. That's been a little bit less successful, and I was thinking about that this morning. Part of that reason is because the CF protein, the CFTR, is so darn good at what it does. The body really doesn't have a whole lot of other things, so we can tweak them, but they still don't work nearly as well as the CFTR does. And then what most of the rest of my talk is about, what Dr. Rosen was giving you all the background for, is this correction of what's wrong with the CF protein. The foundation is really being tenacious about this. They're really being like bulldogs. That's a bit of a stretch. It's true because this is Tyson. This is a puppy we brought him literally 2 days ago. Unfortunately, Tyson was really tired the night we brought him home. It was wonderful, slept all night. Last night, he wanted to play at 3 a.m. And all he wanted to do was play at 3 a.m. And he was very, very interested in the poster that's out there that talks about the CF registry data. And I think he's going to be a scientific dog. So if you see any paw prints on that poster, that's because at 3 a.m. Tyson was walking all over it. How is the CF Foundation looking for these kind of medications that can, you know, help this guy, that can fix these mutant proteins? They're doing something, and they really kind of pioneered it, didn't invent it, but was the first foundation to really push it, this high-throughput screening. It's basically brute force science. It's no longer you're trying to think and be smart about this, say, okay, we know this folds here, well, maybe if we try this or that. No, it's we go out everywhere. We go out, we get samples from under desks in elementary schools where kids stick things and stuff grows. You go into the Amazon, you go into anywhere you can, take a sample of something there, and you put it through a study, and you literally will screen thousands of compounds at a time, just looking to find ones that will help fix the problem you're looking at. There's been over 75 million, and that's not a misprint. There's been over 75 million put in by the CF Foundation. I'm not talking about venture capital. There's been a lot of that put in there. The CF Foundation itself, through funds raised by Great Strides and other things like that, have put $75 million towards pushing it. Because Bob Bell has been the president of the CF Foundation for a while. And he's a very interesting man. He's a very smart man. He is also, actually, a bulldog is a good example, is a good characterization of him. He gets what he wants, he knows where he wants to go, and he attacks it. And you better get on board with him or get out of his way, and he's going to get it done. And that's why the research in CF has pushed to the rate it has been. He's not a CF researcher. He is a PhD doctor, but he's not a researcher. But he gets out there, and he's made the CF Foundation literally the model for foundations of chronic diseases in the country. Nobody else does it as well as CF does. And that has nothing to do with me, Dr. Roshan, John Nash, any of us. That has to do with the people at the foundation. That has to do with people like you and all the others who go out and support and raise money for that. Anyway, I'll stop the ad now. I'll get back to the talk. Brute force approach, literally it's all robots, and these are some pictures of how it works. You set up these assays in these 96 well plates. You go through, the computer says, hey, plate 27, well, 17 had a positive reaction, and then you go and you find that compound, and you purify it, and you try to go on and study it further. It's worked. That's where Kaleidoco came from. That's how we found Kaleidoco. That's how we're looking at many, many other things. And it's now being applied to other diseases like Huntington's chorea and other things like that. Back to the pipeline again. So what I'm talking about here and for the rest of this talk is about fixing the CFTR that's broke, finding some way to fool the body to get it back and working again. First one I'm going to talk about is one that's most furthest out and is proved is Kaleidoco. G551D, you know, basically all these mutations are labeled either by the DNA base pair or by the amino acid. There is an alphabet which I never remember, and I expect you to. But basically, it's a change of the amino acid G to amino acid D at position 551. And this is, as Dr. Rosen says, a class 3 mutation. So the protein actually gets out there, but it doesn't work. This is a model of the protein. That's collider coming in. It causes a change in the protein. So those little balls, which are chloride ions, instead of being stuck in the cell, are now getting out and working the way they're supposed to. Kalydeco works great. I mean, it works absolutely fantastically. And it's a huge treatment effect. This is the only slide like this I'm going to show you, okay? Again, we're trying not to make this a research science talk completely. But all these studies, when you talk about the studies they do, they're all analyzed very, very, very carefully and comparing, again, people who get the medication versus a placebo group on a number of parameters. And this one is lung function as measured by FEV1, the amount of air that you can blow out in the first second, and over a number of weeks. And you can see that the people who got the Kalydeco had a huge improvement in lung function right away that was maintained. All right, computer, you can work now. There are some issues with Kalydeco. It's currently, up until a couple weeks ago, which I'll talk about in two slides, only for the patients with G551D mutation, which is only about 4% of the CF patients. It's a great start, it's not enough. Currently, licensed only for age 6 and above, because that's where the initial studies were done, because you can only do reliable lung function easily in patients 6 and above. You can't take certain medicines or herbal supplements with it. If anyone is enamored of St. John's wort, I don't even know what St. John's wort really does or is supposed to do, but St. John's wort you can't take with Kalydeco. You do need to monitor your liver function for a bit, and it's a somewhat expensive drug. Current list price of $370,000 per year. Now, you know, medicines are like cars. List price is often not what the insurance companies pay or people pay, but this is incredibly expensive. And this isn't a one-time medication. This isn't a medication you take for a year and you fix. This is a medication you take for the rest of your life. So it's rather expensive. It's not the only expensive medicine, but I think it's the one that best fits this person. Which is why you do not want to have a 50% copay insurance. All right, are there other patients with CF who could benefit from Kalydeco? Because Kalydeco is the only one of these medications that's currently approved. Other class 3 mutations, other gating mutations, infants and toddlers, like I said, currently age 6, and other mutations that can result in some function like that. End of February, the FDA kind of approved 9 other mutations for Kalydeco. And again, we're not going to go through each of them, but up until February 21st, I could only prescribe Kalydeco for somebody with G551D. Now we can do the rest of them. In the U.S., there are approximately 1,140 patients with G551D. Adding these other ones add about 260 patients more. Again, not huge numbers, but pushes you from about 4% to 5%. Where do we go from here? The foundation really hit a home run. Kalydeco is a blooming great drug. I know I said that before, but we have a number of patients with this. And my biggest problem with them, quite frankly, is what I mentioned to you before. It works so well that I need to get on a case to remind them, yes, you still have some lung damage, so you still need to do your pulmonary, you need to do your vest, you need to do things like that, because it makes them feel so well, they don't want to do that. We've now been around long enough that those patients have also found out that if they don't do their other treatments, they still will get sick. But it works really, really well. So now our challenge is finding therapies that will correct CFTR for all CF mutations. And I'll mention again at the end of the talk, Dr. Rosen mentioned it twice already, the foundation is absolutely, absolutely dedicated to doing that. And I mentioned before about Bob Bell's tenacity. Well, that's something he's being very tenacious about. The foundation is going to keep pushing until we have a cure for everybody. It will take time, hard work, and patience, again, for doing direct studies. Back to the pipeline. Talk about a drug that's not approved yet, but getting near the end, for Adalorin. This is a different class of mutation. This is one where the protein that doesn't get made because the cell's machinery to get the protein usually you kind of run down this code. At this point, it's in actually RNA, not DNA. But you know, as the body's making the protein, you know, normally you start here, come to a stop sign, okay, it's done, and you got a protein. In some of these mutations, if you have a mutation in the middle that makes kind of a fake stop sign, you know, it's kind of like the guy who thinks people are speeding too much goes out the front lawn and taps in an octagonal red sign and tries to get people to slow down. It's starting. Where my arrow go? I lost my point. There it is. You know, so it starts here, and then hits this and stops. So you get a protein that's not fully made. What Adalorin does is it binds to the machinery in the cell that's doing that and says, okay, ignore that fake machine. It's not a real one. You know it's not a real one. Go through it, and we'll stop at the real one. The phase 3 studies for that, or the first phase 3 study, was just recently reported at the last CF meeting last fall. And unfortunately, it worked, but not as well as we would like. Again, this is another graph looking at lung function, just like I showed you the Kaleidico graph for the dotted line of the placebo or the sugar pill, and the solid yellow line of the people who got the medication. Lung function was better, but it was not significantly better. Now, what they did, if anybody's participating in any of these studies, I mean, nobody's done as many as Mark Guntram has, but anybody's participating in them knows that we collect a lot of things, not just lung function. And if they broke it up and looked at people who were taking TOBI versus those who weren't taking TOBI, they found that it was a big difference, that in the patients who were taking TOBI, which is on the right here, the trackpad's getting tired. On the right there wasn't much of a difference. But if you look at the ones who'd never had TOBI before, there was a difference. One of the reasons for this may be that we've known for a long time that medicines like TOBI, if they get into the cell, actually can cause that read-through of a premature stop codon. They actually, some of the original studies that were done with a drug called gentamicin, which is very similar to tobramycin, to see if that could do the same thing we're trying to do with the Adalorin. And that wasn't as effective, but certainly this gives them a way to go forward and looking forward study. So they're doing another phase 3 looking at patients not on TOBI. That doesn't mean that if you have these mutations, they want you to stop taking TOBI, especially not now. But you know, the research is continuing for that medication. Now, the last thing I'm going to talk about is kind of where we're going, sort of the next step, the current future step, which is using a combination therapy for treating things. Oh, by the way, you may have noticed at the end of Dr. Rosen's slide, you hear us all talk about Delta F508. Well, just like the people at work, I'm sure everyone has this, where there's just some form you need to fill out every year, and every year it's a slightly different form because somebody's got a job and you just come up with a new form. Same thing happens here. Somebody has a job that changes how these are named. So Delta F508 is no longer officially called Delta F508. It's now F508-DEL. Same mutation, same problem. And another one of these animations, which I blatantly stole from the CF Foundation, by the way, that shows. So this is the protein being made, and it doesn't fold correctly. You know, so it's non-functional, and most of it gets taken to the garbage cans, you know, of the body, so most of it just disappears. A little bit of it, even in patients with F508-DEL, will get out of the cell surface, very small amounts, and it doesn't work well when it gets there. That's why it's colored black. So not as much as it should be out there, doesn't work. Those nice little chloride ions, those little spheres just don't make it out. So how can you fix it? Well, it's gonna be likely a two-step process. Because one, you need to get more of it out there. Two, you need to get it working better. So here we have, again, the abnormal thing. And then this is a new medication coming in which makes it fold correctly. And so now you have more of them, and that they can be functional. They get out to the cell surface. We're not there yet. We're kind of taking our vehicle up there and get to the cell surface. And it can work. Now, it's not working great, okay? very low count there. So you bring in something like Kalydeco, and all of a sudden it starts working better. So two things: a corrector to actually get it folded correctly and out there, and a potentiator. Don't need to remember those names. I still get confused with those names. But basically, one medicine to make it fold and get to where it's supposed to be, and another medicine, which is Kalydeco, that's what they're studying, to make it work better when it gets there. In early studies of this, using Kalydeco, which is the ivacaftor, and the first generation, and I'll emphasize first generation of this, and looking at patients with two copies of the F508del. Again, guidelines placebo, and then this is the active drug. You are seeing improvement. This is only 56 days. Again, this is a phase 2 study. So this is an active phase 3. So it's actually a phase 3 study. Teresa isn't here today. She had something. I think both phase 3 studies are finished. We actually participated in this phase 3 study. And the data has not been analyzed, but will be coming out. Bottom line in trying to correct F508del, and why are we focusing on F508del? As Dr. Rosen said, 80% of the patients have at least one copy of this. 50% of the patients, roughly, have two copies of this. So while we're not going to stop there either, if we can find some way to fix this particular mutation, we're miles ahead of where we are now with Kalydeco, which is 4-5%. Significant progress has been made with patients with two F508del. And the studies that were just finished were on people with both of them. Correction, it's a multi-step process, requires more than one drug. If the patient has only one copy of it, which again, about 30% of the patients have just one copy of F508del and another mutation, the clinical response was not that good. So at least the current ones we have are not good enough. So what do we have? Well, since this is a long process, the foundation had some inklings of this going on many years ago. So they've been looking at it for a while. They said, okay, we've had these things that worked. What worked in what we did? What didn't work? What we did? What can we do to make this process faster the next time around? Create a roadmap for more robust second generation compounds, and there's already one that's in the pipeline, just a few steps behind the what's called the Lumacaftor or VX809. Strong partners in place. Again, partnering with industry. This is the other thing that Bob Bell did many years ago that really made this work. So we're not going to be able to do this with a bunch of egghead scientists in the university lab. And I did do research for a bit. I have a PhD, so I can call myself an egghead scientist at one point in time. You need to get the companies involved. You need to get companies like Vertex, and now they're expanding to many others. Making progress, they've got new screening, better, even more efficient, a high-throughput screening, and they're planning to look at up to 6 million new compounds to find stuff. So, to kind of wrap up, again, goal, developing disease-modifying therapies, treating a basic defect, cures. We're talking about cures here for 100% of patients with CF. And there are other things being done other than just correcting the specific mutations, gene replacement, gene repair, mRNA and protein replacement, lots of things going on. As I said, gene therapy is not being pursued a whole lot in the U.S. right now, but there's a huge consortium in the U.K. that is looking at it very hard and making great strides with it. So the whole purpose of this, what we're trying to do, is take CF from the disease it was back in the 50s, 60s, 70s. Many of the people in this room know this already, but for those who don't, I had two cousins with CF. They were born in 73 and 74. When they were born, they were told the life expectancy was in their early teens. They both unfortunately passed away. They both passed away about age 30. So CF is not the disease it was now. We're trying to change this into what we're seeing of CF patients in this day and age. So thank you for your attention. Obviously, need to acknowledge all the people at both the Adult and Pediatric CF Center, my partner, Dr. Kislowski, Dr. Rosen's partner, Dr. Smith, nurse practitioners, Steve and Therese, our nurse coordinators, Hannah for the pediatric group, and Sarah. In the adult group, research nurses, Teresa does double duty for those who don't know. She's also a research nurse. And Kathy, our respiratory therapist, and Lonnie and Jean, social workers Kim and John, our dietitians, Evelyn Joyce, and child life therapist. Sorry, in the adult clinic there is no child life therapist. Lisa, and thank you again for your attention, and enjoy the rest of the day.